we got the call, I think it was like at 10:30 at night, roughly. End up meeting up at Green Spring Station, all the other four engines. And we left to go towards the Inyo National Forest. I believe we got down there about 3 in the morning. And we stayed at a conservation camp. So we arrived roughly about 7 something, watched the fire behavior on the hill, and it was spotting pretty good. We knew usually the conditions, like, it was spotting maybe a half mile, so those conditions were pretty good already at 7 in the morning. We knew we were in for it in a little bit. So we got a briefing from our chief, warning us about the eastern side of the Sierra Nevadas, you know, pretty much telling us don't want to get in front of them. Talking about safety issues. He had us go out and scout the area. There's a few homes, maybe 25, 50 homes in the area. And he had us drive up and down the roads, checking them out. There was a nice little, I would say like a little riparian area where the probably 50 to 75 foot trees maybe, pretty green. And we didn't check that out in the morning. Didn't know much about it, but there was a bridge leading over there. So the chief had us go back there and check it out.
Our crew got on our engine and went across the bridge and realized we were on somebody's little compound. It looked like somebody set up a homestead and they were dug in for the long haul. They had a main house and several outhouses and then about the mid entrance of the compound, they had dug out a large area for a pond. And sure enough, the fire got closer to the road and we noticed that we were getting a spot or two within this compound. So the supervisor made a decision and we were all pretty comfortable with it that we're gonna get the spots and get out. And if things go bad, you know, we're gonna go in this pond. So at the time I didn't really think about it because it wasn't a situation where I felt really threatened. It just seemed like a little cleanup, get in and get out. But then we started noticing a couple of different things. We noticed that we had an individual who lived on the compound that she was trying to pack up her knickknacks one by one to her car and she didn't want to leave her knickknacks. And we, as nicely as we could, got her in her vehicle and helped her get out of the area. At the same time, we're catching multiple spots and we thought we'd hit these spots and get out as soon as we got the lady out of the area. So one of my partners, there was four of us, one of my partners went and started a hose lay. Two of my other partners, they started catching some spots, so they started another hose lay. And the operator at the time, he decided to take a tool and take care of some areas and kind of get a walk around real quick of what was going on and see if we had any issues. I was trying to help everybody with what they needed, whether it was hose or whatnot. And at that point, I realized that everybody was doing something and I had another engine coming in and I was trying to make contact with them to see what they needed and let them know what we were doing. After I tied in with them, their supervisor decided to back up what we were doing and help out with the hose lays.
I was pretty much on my own with the 100 foot, just thinking like, okay, what am I gonna do by myself? I'm thinking, all right, do I leave the hose or go back for more another pack or just stay here and do what I can? But about that time, another engine had been sent in to come help us. The three firefighters from that engine and the captain came out and they got packs and they came out with me and we started progressing. Well, the captain started walking the outline of the riparian area and he took off. And maybe a minute or two after he took off, we were trying to clamp the hose and the fuels on the ground caught into the canopy as we were trying to clamp the hose. And it just was just too late by that time. By the time we got it clamped and everything, it was already starting to run in the canopy. And I wasn't too sure if those guys knew exactly if there was a pond. So I remember telling them, get to the effing pond. You know, this crap's about to blow up.
It's just getting really loud and calling for my supervisor, my operator, and my crew members, hey, you know, get out, let's get back to the pond. But it just didn't seem like I was screaming. It seemed like I was talking very low. And the noise was just so loud, I couldn't hear myself. That's when I think I realized this is a little bit bigger than what I thought it was. I looked around real quick to see if I could make a run for the bridge, and then realized, well, no, it's coming from that area. I looked at where my coworkers were and saw that it was getting bigger, and it was now going lateral and coming across the tops, and realized, well, I need to make a decision on where I'm going to go, because nobody's coming towards me, nobody's going towards the pond yet. So about the time I decided to turn around and run for the pond, then I kind of felt everybody coming in the same direction towards this pond. So I'm trying to run towards the pond and dragging my day pack and pull out the shelter at the same time. And I realized, well, I better do one thing at a time or so. I stopped for a second, opened up the pack, and looked over to make sure I was still going in the right direction of the pond. And I was fumbling for my shelter. Somebody brushed by me, and I realized, okay, maybe I should get in the water now versus try to deploy the shelter here. So I'm about ankle deep in the water, and people are starting to come towards the water and getting in the water. And I just remember looking up to see how bad it was, and everything was red. It seemed like the treetops were red. No matter which direction I looked in, it just seemed like this wasn't getting any better. It was getting a lot worse. So at that point, I think I just kind of threw myself in the water and was still fumbling with the pack. And I remember looking up because I could feel heat coming from the top down right through all my gear. And I'm still kind of not all the way in the water. And I look up and it's overhead, and it's just red and orange above me. So I'm trying to get the pack out, and it still is not coming out. The plastic rings pop off. The strap didn't want to come off. The plastic didn't want to come off the shelter itself. And so at some point, I just kind of took the shelter and was kind of putting it between me and what felt like the hottest spot, which was right above the right side of my head. And I'm staring at what just seems like chaos to me, but at the same time, trying to fumble with the pack. So after about a couple seconds, I finally get the pack open, and I'm pretty much under in the water. And now I'm starting to get the pack open and the shelter deployed, and even with the shelter open, I still decided, well, I'm just going to keep myself a little bit more in the water than anything else. So I had the shelter open but deployed, but I kept most of my body and my head at water, and I tried keeping my eyes above the water, but it was just so hot that it didn't help. I would stick my head underwater for a second or two and then come back up. It was pretty nerve-wracking because everybody was either screaming for each other or going through some pretty tough emotions at the time.
And eventually got to the pond. They were standing at the pond. I was knee-deep almost already by then, and waist-deep maybe. And just telling them, get in the pond. And at that time I realized, oh, crap, better get my shelter out. So I got my shelter out, and I remember just trying to pull the straps, and I kind of caught. And so I was like, I don't think I have enough time to get this out. So I just, fire started coming over our head, and I was just like, I'm in here, because, you know, you always hear that the heated gases, you know, is what's going to kill you. It's going to burn your lungs. So I just took a last breath and held my nose and went under the water, and was just thinking, just try to stay under here as long as I can, and just don't want to come up for air and die, I guess. So I stayed down there, and just remember hearing people in the water, like, kind of like screaming or something a little bit. I don't know if it was yelling or a little bit of screaming. Wasn't sure what was going on, so it made me kind of freak out a little bit under the water. It's kind of like, oh my God, I don't want to die like this. And I think as I was sitting under the water thinking, I was like, well, maybe if I just come up, you know, because I was getting out of breath, I was like, if I just come up and do a quick and then go back under, I'll be all right. So I was debating on that, so I started like trying to drink the water as I was underwater, as I'm holding my breath before I come up. Finally, I couldn't do that no more, so I came up, did a quick little breath, and went back under. I did that a few times, and then finally I heard people talking when I'd come up, and so I was like, they were trying to get accountability, and so I heard that, and I came up and just realized what was going on kind of with everything around us.
In the water, we were there for a couple minutes, and there was just a lot of unusual noises, things popping and things making really unusual booms, and we weren't sure what was happening. We just knew that this isn't right. This doesn't feel right. So for our supervisors, we were like, okay, we're gonna get out of the water and we might try to make a run for it. So we're gonna get to the engine and see what we can do from there. So we got out of the water and we started walking towards one of the engines, and we all had the few of us that did have our shelters, we kind of huddled around those that didn't have the shelters, and we walked towards the engine. And we were between the engine and the structure, and the supervisors were trying to assess what they were gonna do.
I asked the captain, I said, "You guys got an extra shelter? I dropped mine in the water." And he's like, "It's in the engine." Well, I got in the engine and pulled that shelter out and pulled the straps, got it out, got ready to just hunker down in there on the inside the little site where we were. It was all pretty much bare minimum soil, nothing, you know, just dirt. So got that all ready, and then they wanted us to kind of try to save the engine. But like, I think an ember or a stick or something had burned one of the lines, so couldn't get really any water out. But we did what we could, and then the structures caught on fire, and the structure was next to like a 500-gallon propane tank. So eventually that caused us to go back into the pond. We all retreated back to the pond. Propane tank started to vent like right after we got in the pond. Then I think I took my shelter and kind of used it as like a bubble, I guess, and just kind of enclosed it all around, sat there just begging mercy. I can't wait to get out of this, thinking I hope those guys on the outside are coming in, putting this thing out. And then eventually you can hear the aircraft, you know, dropping on us. And I think it was about an hour and a half later that we eventually got out of there. But that was pretty much the only time I really used the shelter, was in there. And, you know, eventually I'd take a peek out when I felt more safe. And we walked out, I don't know, like I said, an hour and a half later, and that was about it.